Hi everyone, and a very warm welcome from the UK to today's online service. I'm Stephen, and this is my wife Shahana, and we're part of the leadership team of senior pastors Wes and Adriana Richards at King's Church International in Windsor.
And as always, we give a very special welcome to everyone from King's Church International in Windsor, London, and in Robertson, South Africa, and to everyone joining us from around the UK and other nations. Wherever you are, we want you to know that God loves you and has a special plan for your life.
Last week, we started a very relevant new preaching series called Living God's Way, focused on the Ten Commandments. These famous and foundational commandments were given out by the love by a God who wants to, you know, give us freedom in our personal lives and in society. If you didn't hear this powerful opening talk by Pastor Adriana, please take the time to catch up. In today's program, one of our leaders from Windsor, Ed Turkington, will be explaining and applying the second commandment, "You shall make no idols."
We will also have an inspiring feature from several of our senior leaders in Windsor and in Robertson, South Africa, who will be sharing a scripture that they feel is particularly applicable to them in 2023. And this is sometimes known as a rhema word. Rhema is Greek for word, and a rhema word is a specific verse or now word from the Bible that God lights up to us for a particular time or circumstance.
Yes, it is amazing how the Bible can speak to us all when we read it and study it prayerfully. There is so much to discover as a Christian. If you want to know more about real Christianity or to grow in your faith, then please stay tuned for later in the program, where we'll be giving details about live class and online courses which start in a couple of weeks.
And if you want to develop as a Christian leader, we'd love for you to join our Destiny training course, and full details of the course will be shared later in the program. So loads of good things coming up, but first as always, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are Lord of all, that you are the creator of the world and everything in it. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us teaching in the Bible on how to live your way, which we know will give us a hope and a future. And today, Lord, we come with open and humble hearts, and we ask you to speak to us through this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Now let's worship the Lord together.
Ooh, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice.
Here I am, here you are, I give all of me. Show me your glory, you're all I want, you're all I need, show me your glory, you are good, every step. I let your Spirit lead. Valleys low or on mountain peaks, I will follow you, 'cause I know you'll never leave. One thing I ask, one thing I seek, show me your glory, your thank you.
John 4:23-24.
Yes, a time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks.
God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the spirit and in the truth.
Deuteronomy 4:15-20. You saw no form of any kind the day the Lord spoke to you at Horeb out of the fire. Therefore, watch yourselves very carefully, so that you do not become corrupt and make for yourselves an idol, an image of any shape, whether formed like a man or a woman, or like an animal on earth, or any bird that flies in the air, or like any creature that moves along the ground, or any fish in the waters below.
And when you look up to the sky and see the sun, the moon, and the stars, all the heavenly array, do not be enticed into bowing down to them and worshipping the things the Lord your God has apportioned to all the nations under heaven. But as for you, the Lord took you and brought you out of the iron smelting furnace, out of Egypt, to be the people of his inheritance, as you now are.
Isaiah 42:8. I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not yield my glory to another, or my praise to idols.
Colossians 3:1-2. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your heart on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things.
Romans 12:1. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing God. This is your true and proper worship.
At the start of 2023, it is important for us to hear what God has to say to us. My Rhema word for this year is victory and reaping. Despite many challenges, God has been faithful to us in so many ways. Hebrews 13:6-8 says, so we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Amen. Pastors Wes and Adriana invested in us personally and the church for many years. And I believe with God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and our senior pastors, we are going to see growth in numbers, but also new leaders who take up the responsibility of disciple makers.
Amen. My Rhema word for 2023 is conquer. When I think of the word conquer, I think of Joshua. The first part of Joshua 6:27 says, so the Lord was with Joshua. We all know he faced many challenges, but every time God came miraculously through for him because the Lord was with him. I also realized to conquer many things in this year, whether it is personal, in our business, or in ministry, I must be obedient to God. I want to be committed to the G12 vision. This year, I would like to complete my team of 12, and also I want to help the ladies in my life group to start their life groups. I also believe if I'm committed to God, it says in Matthew 6:33, but seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to me. I know the Lord is with me, and he will help me to conquer many things in 2023.
Our Rhema word for this year is from John 15:4, which says, remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. And this has really spoken to us this year, because we really believe that as we invest in the Lord, as we make him our priority, as we stand firm upon his promises, as we consecrate ourselves to him, then we're going to be fruitful in all areas. That's and we right. believe this as a promise for us this year.
Yeah.
In every area of our lives, we really want to see growth in the young people. We really want to see God's favour and blessing upon our lives. And we just believe that if we stand upon this, then we're going to see God move.
That's right. And it's, you know, it's a daily thing. I think it's the thing that the Lord given us his word for now, is that he's calling us to be closer to him at a whole new level in every area, every detail of our lives, every day, to come back to him and just rely on him to be our strength, to be our light, to encourage us, to keep us moving forward. And he says we'll bear fruit if we remain in him, if we focus on him and commit ourselves to him every day. And this year, we know it's going to be a year of just incredible growth and blessing this year for us, for the ministry, what God's doing in the young people as well. We believe this is a great time for this word to come into fruition. Amen. This year. So we're very excited for what God's going to do.
And the Rhema word that we are standing on in 2023 is Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 to 19. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland.
At the beginning of this year, Mike and I prayed for a Rhema word for our lives and our family's life, and also for our life group. And the Lord gave us this special word, a word that we could stand on, that would guide us through this whole year. And we believe that the Lord is indeed going to do new things in our lives that we haven't seen before, that we're going to see healings, that we're going to see miracles that we have been praying for and breakthroughs in many people's lives, and that we're going to see new fruit come into our life groups that we've been praying for such a long time. But in order to do that, we know that the Lord is saying we need to forget the former things, forget what has gone on before, and look and visualize something new.
Our Rhema word for this year is Psalm 121.
And it says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore.
As children of God, me and my family, we stand on this word because it tells us that we are under the Lord's protection. We are under his defense, and also under his watchful care.
And I believe for the church, for KCI, this is a very important word for this year, because the Lord promises that he will watch over us. He will watch over our coming and our going, both now and forevermore.
I'd like to invite you to Life Class. This is a course for new Christians. It's a course for people that are new to the church, or just for people that want to strengthen their faith in the Lord.
Life Class is an introduction to Christianity to strengthen the faith of new believers, and it is a great preparation for a real spiritual experience of an encounter with Jesus.
You will receive extensive support to grow in your Christian life with helpful tools to help you develop in prayer and reading the Bible.
To learn how to live life the way God intended, and that is life to the full, with a hope and a future.
It's an opportunity for you to have a personal encounter with Jesus and move forward in your relationship with him.
It's a 9-week course that runs once a week for an hour. And in week 5, there's a very special encounter weekend.
If you want to grow in your love for God, your maturity in your faith, and your fruitfulness in the church, then we want to invite you to join us for the next term of Destiny Training.
Destiny Training is a focus course designed by Pastor Cesar Castellanos, who grew the MCI Church in Bogota from 8 people to over 100,000 in the space of about 2 decades.
It's split into 3 10-week terms, and its purpose is to help form you as a disciple.
That's level 1.
Equip you in how to effectively live out and share your faith.
Level 2.
And then lead you into a close walk with the Holy Spirit
as you learn to shepherd those that God has entrusted to you.
And that's level 3. In the Great Commission of Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, Jesus commanded his disciples to go and make disciples. He would then go and do the same, i.e. to make more disciples. That means that every one of us is commanded to become a disciple maker.
And Ephesians 4 tells us how. It says that Jesus has given us various kinds of leaders to train up the church until we all reach maturity and unity.
These two passages present us with a high calling, but a great privilege, and it is held out to every one of us.
Each week, you'll be taught two topics in the Destiny Training class.
Then you go away to read through the chapters in your own time.
There'll be a practical application on how to apply the lessons.
And then the opportunity to speak to your cell leader and talk it through and pray over it.
And to book on, you'll need to be in a cell group or ready to join one, and to have completed Life Class. You can book on at kcionline.org/destinytraining.
Hi everyone, I'm Ed Turkington and I'm part of the 12 team of Senior Pastor Wes Richards. Our new series, Living God's Way, shows us how to live the best life. It is based on the Ten Commandments, which we saw in a powerful introduction last week, are very relevant and much needed today. The commandments, far from being negative and destructive, actually provide the strongest foundation for living, for individuals, for families, and for nations. As has been so many times in our history, they guard our freedoms and save us from pain and oppression. We saw last week that God gives the Ten Commandments, not the Ten Suggestions. These truths are absolute and unchangeable. They're not subject to our revisions as we see fit. These rules flow from biblical teaching that there is a God far superior to humans. The God who spoke to Moses cares for us like no one else does. He wants us to avoid trouble by following the Maker's instructions. So today, we are focusing on the second commandment, which is distinct from the first commandment, that you shall have no other gods before me, but actually it is quite linked. This is what it says in Exodus 20, verses 4 and 5. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, on the earth beneath, or the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, Moses expands on this. He says, you saw no form of any kind on the day that the Lord spoke to you at Horeb out of the fire. Therefore, watch yourselves very carefully so that you do not become corrupt and make for yourselves an idol, an image of any shape, whether formed like a man or a woman or like an animal. Or in verse 28, it says, man-made gods of wood and stone, which cannot see or hear or eat or smell. Well, you might imagine that having seen the power of the one true God of Israel deliver them from Egypt and bring them through the Red Sea, that of course God's people wouldn't have any other gods or make any images of other gods. But incredibly, the Israelites so quickly turned from worshipping God to worshipping an idol. When Moses came down Mount Sinai, having received the commandments, he discovered wild scenes of revelry as the Israelites sacrificed offerings to a golden cow that they had made from their own personal items of gold. Moses' own brother, Aaron, was involved in this mass rejection of God, making this pathetic excuse, saying, they gave me the gold and I threw it into the fire and out came this calf. All this shows how quickly our hearts can be given over to idols. A short while after I'd become a Christian, I remember reading this commandment and thinking, idolatry isn't really a problem in the world anymore. I couldn't imagine anyone I knew bowing down before anything man-made to honour and serve it. But a little while later, I passed by a man kneeling down next to his sleek, beautiful sports car. He had all his dedicated car cleaning stuff around him, and he looked like he'd spent hours washing, drying, and waxing it.
I suddenly realised I was quite wrong. Idolatry has not disappeared in the West, it has only changed shape. The early Christian scholar Origen of Alexandria described idolatry like this: what each one honours before all else, what before all things he admires and loves, this for him is God. So many things in life that can be a blessing can also take the place of God in our hearts and replace him as our priority in life. Exercise, for example, is vital for healthy living, and playing a game like football is both healthy and fun. Supporting a sports team can make a great pastime, but for many enthusiasts, their sport grows into a consuming priority that displaces every other activity. And images are often linked to that. For example, bedroom posters of celebrities, branded clothes, trinkets. J. John explained in his book, God's Top 10, that when something becomes your reason for living, you have effectively bowed down to it. It could be an object, it could be something quite different. Is there something that you are always pursuing? The perfect home, the latest car, your next promotion? He writes, those deep desires show what is really the most important thing in our lives. And that is the place where God should be, the most important, most all-consuming passion. Anything that is there instead of him is an idol. This command to have no idols was not given to spoil our freedom of choice, but to protect us from devoting our lives and focusing on things that ultimately replace God. I want to share with you now three reasons why you mustn't worship idols. Firstly, you shall not worship idols because the one true God is a living being, not a created thing. There is a big difference between God and idols. God is alive. Idols are lifeless. Idols are literally dumb. Listen to the contrast between God and idols. The prophet Jeremiah warned Israel time and again to throw away idols that are blind, deaf, mute, and so worthless that they have to be nailed down to stop them from toppling over. In Jeremiah chapter 10, he said of idols, they cut a tree out of the forest, and a craftsman shapes it with his chisel. They adorn it with silver and gold. They fasten it with hammer and nails so it will not totter. Like a scarecrow in a cucumber field, their idols cannot speak. They must be carried because they cannot walk. Do not fear them. They can do no harm, nor can they do any good. Then, speaking of God, he writes, no one is like you, Lord. You are great, and your name is mighty in power. Among all the wise leaders of the nations, in all their kingdoms, there is no one like you. The Lord is the true God. He is the living God, the eternal King. He who is the portion of Jacob is not like these, for he is the maker of all things. Psalm 115 describes the powerlessness of idols. They have mouths but cannot speak, eyes but cannot see, they have ears but cannot hear, noses but cannot smell, they have hands but cannot feel, feet but cannot walk, nor can they utter a sound with their throats. Those who make them will be like them, and so will all who trust in them. These verses highlight the utter foolishness of worshipping an idol. Idols are no comparison to our God. These ancient idols sound absurd, don't they? Why would anybody bow down to one of these? But what of our modern equivalents? We have invented much cleverer and more entertaining idols to look at than a carved block of wood. For example, smartphones, smart TVs, tablets, games consoles. They may seem a lot more useful than a statue, but that doesn't stop them from being idols. The average adolescent spends 7.5 hours per day looking at screens, and the average daily phone use by UK adults rose by 0.5 hour each year between 2019 and 2021, from 3 to 4 hours per day. Now that can't all have been spent on the Bible app and the KCI YouTube channel. So what are you looking at? Seriously, are you watching anything that you shouldn't be? How much of your time and relationship with God have you shortchanged for social media, news, games, images? You're here now watching this, so it can't be all bad, but what draws your heart and where are you trying to find your satisfaction? Do you put church on hold every time there's a busy period in your academic studies because getting the best grades and academic accolades is the highest priority in your life? Or do you work all hours to pursue bonuses, promotions, because money and power are the two things that really make you feel fulfilled? Do you chase endlessly after possessions and property or relationships and social events for a buzz of contentment and satisfaction? These things may seem to have everything that we really want, but actually they are lifeless. They offer you nothing compared to God. If you elevate any of these things to the extreme, you will make less and less time to seek out the presence of God. And this brings me onto the next point. Secondly, you shall not worship idols because the one true God has no rival or equal. Exodus 20 verse 5 in the Good News Translation says, "Do not bow down to any idol or worship it, because I am the Lord your God and I tolerate no rivals." Isaiah 42, 8 says, "I alone am the Lord your God. No other God may share my glory. I will not let idols share my praise." You might ask, why not? Because there is no other God. There is nothing and no one that has any right or authority to take his place in your life. It's not that he's insecure about power sharing. God is perfect and holy, and he is the only one worthy of being worshipped. But also, he is supremely faithful, and to have a relationship with him demands that we also are faithful. Marriage gives us a good illustration of this. Good marriages are based on an exclusive commitment to one another. Any other potential lover is forbidden. It's heartbreaking when people find that the one that they loved and trusted has betrayed them. That's why the wedding vows include the words "forsaking all others." And it is the same with God. Worshipping idols is like taking other lovers and betraying your relationship with God. Jesus specifically mentioned money as one of the biggest potential rivals to loving God. Money must never be an idol in your life. Jesus said in Matthew 6:24, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." John Wesley famously showed us how we can keep money in its right place in our lives. He said, "Earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can." So then, first of all, don't worship other gods or focus on idols, because the one true God is a living God, not a created thing. Also, the one true God has no rival or equal. And thirdly, you shall not worship idols because only the one true God can truly satisfy your heart. Blaise Pascal described it like this: "There is a God-shaped vacuum in the human heart which cannot be satisfied by any created thing, but only by God, the Creator, made known through Jesus Christ." The most important reason we must not allow any idols to take first place in our lives is that they rob and distract us from the most perfect relationship imaginable. There is a God in heaven who knows you by name. He created you for relationship with himself, and he loves you more than anyone on earth. Psalm 139 describes how deeply he cares for us. It says, "You know me. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before me, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God." There is no relationship in the universe that can compare to a relationship with your Father in heaven. Today, take a moment to evaluate your priorities in life and recognize the emptiness of man-made gods and idols. Don't waste your life on things that don't matter. Make a decision right now to get rid of any idols that are in your life. As Joshua said in Joshua 24, verse 23 in the New Living Translation, destroy the idols among you and turn your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. And then commit to obeying this commandment and to knowing the living God who loves you and who has the power to save you just as he delivered the Israelites from Egypt. Let's pray. If you want to know the one true God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, then you can today. Please pray with me. Lord Jesus, thank you for your great love for me. Thank you that because you suffered and died on the cross, I can be saved from all my sins. So please cleanse me and help me to follow you always and love you with all my heart. Amen. Well, God hears and answers prayers like that, and he welcomes you into his family. As a church family, we too would love to help you grow in your faith, so please contact us. And now, I would like to pray a prayer for every Christian to be fully devoted to the Lord. Father in heaven, Lord, you are our first love, and we want to serve you wholeheartedly all of our lives. Help us not to allow anything to become an idol, not to allow anything to take too much of our time, Lord, away from you. Give us wisdom, Lord, in how we use our time, Lord, that we may honour you and know you so intimately. Lord, I pray that you would guide us, every one of us, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. And now let's worship our final song.
I'm returning to the secret place, just an altar and a flame. Love is found here in our secret place. I hear your voice, I see your face. You're still my first. There's a table just for you and me. Break the bread and pour the wine. Perfect union, nothing in between. I am yours and you are mine. You're still.
Thank you for joining us today. If you have any prayer requests, please contact us at hello@kcionline.org. Or for more information about our church, please visit our website at kcionline.org. To stay connected with us, please go to kcionline.org/connect. Or if you would like to find out more about giving, please go to kcionline.org/giving. And to listen to all our services, go to kcionline.org/podcast or simply download the KCI app on the App Store. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel of King's Church International and our senior pastors Wes and Adriana. We welcome you to join us again every Sunday at 5 p.m. UK time. God bless you.